ago, the notion of England helping Russia and Japan destroy Germany would have seemed as suicidal as Canada helping the Apaches to destroy the United States of America. And though we now think much better of the Japanese, and also, by the way, of the Apaches, that does not make us any the more patient with the man who burns down his own street because he admires the domestic architecture of Yokohama, especially when the fire presently spreads to the cathedral of Rome. It is bad enough that we should have betrayed Oriental Persia to Oriental Russia as we did, and get nothing for our pains but what we deserved. But when it comes to sacrificing occidental Germany to her as well, we are sharpening a knife for our own occidental throat. The Russian liberty we boast of Charles the First's unsuccessful attempt to arrest 5 members of the House of Commons for disagreeing with him is ancient history here. It occurred 272 years ago, but the czars successful attempt to arrest 30 members of the Duma and to punish them as dangerous criminals is a fact of today. Under Russian government, people whose worst crime is to find the daily news a congenial newspaper are hanged, flogged, or sent to Siberia as a matter of daily routine, so that before 1906 even the articles in the Times on such events as the assassinations of Bobrikov and the Grand Duke were simply polite paraphrases of "Serve him right." It may be asked why our newspapers have since ceased to report examples of Russia's disregard the political principles we are supposed to stand for. The answer is simple. It was in 1906 that we began to lend Russia money, and Russia began to advertise in the Times. Since then, she has been welcome to flog and hang her H.G. Wells's and Lloyd George's by the dozen without a word of remonstrance from our plutocratic press, provided the interest is paid punctually. Russia has been embraced in the large charity of cosmopolitan capital, the only charity that does not begin